Hello, I'm Robin Worley, welcome to LensCraft. Today I'm looking at On1 Photo RAW, and what I want to do is demonstrate some of the obvious editing tools that we tend to overlook. Typically, these are going to be things that you know about, but you may have started to ignore. I'm hoping they'll prompt you to explore some new ideas about how you edit your own work. I won't present them in any order other than I'll be editing this image, so I'll be pointing things out as and when I use them. When I've done this in the past with the likes of Nick, people have commented that they didn't realise or have forgotten that they could do these things. I'm hoping it's the same with On1 because it's a very flexible package and can produce some very good results. I'm starting with my image in Photoshop because I'm going to apply the adjustments using On1 as a plugin. Whilst On1 is a great one-stop editing environment, what I love is that I can also use it as a Photoshop plugin, and it also works with Affinity Photo. One of the things that I like about using On1 as a plugin in Photoshop is that it works as a smart filter. If I convert my layer to use smart filters when I make my adjustments, they're saved as part of the Photoshop image file. This allows me to reopen On1 in the future to change the filters and settings I used. To make my adjustments to this image, I'm going to use the filters in the On1 Effects plugin. I find these filters are extremely effective and have some great masking tools. After On1 Effects opens, I can use the presets and filters on the left of the interface, or alternatively, I can add individual filters on the right. The presets are collections of filters and settings that have been created and then saved into several groups. What tends to happen when editing is that we become locked into a certain way of working. People tend to gravitate either towards adding individual filters or applying default presets. As I normally work by adding individual filters, I'm going to start today with a preset. When I select the landscape group, you can see all the installed presets in that category. If I click the perfect sunshine preset, you can see the effect applied to the image. The filters used in the preset then appear on the right of the interface. The unfortunate thing that I find with most of the presets is that the effect is too strong for my taste. Despite this, the presets can still be extremely useful by applying an overlooked tool, the Opacity Slider. The main Opacity Slider applies to all the filters that have been added and appears at the top. It's the one that's still visible when all the filters are collapsed like this. When you reduce the opacity, you reduce the strength of all the filters to an equal degree. Then, in addition to the overall opacity slider, each filter has its own opacity control. This means you can control the strength of individual filters and how much each one contributes to the overall effect. Often when we don't like the effect a preset creates, it's usually because the overall effect is strong, or maybe we need to adjust the balance between the individual filters. Let's say we decide to use the Big Softy preset for the vignette filter. We like the effect, but think that it's too strong for this image. A common reaction is to start fiddling with the brightness slider and possibly the size control, when a much easier option is just to reduce the filter opacity. If you later feel the vignette needs to be stronger, you simply increase the opacity again. Now let's take this a little bit further. We've already selected the perfect sunshine preset and applied this to the image. Whilst the effect is eye-catching, it's too strong for how I imagine the image would look when edited. What I can do is work my way down the list of filters to turn each one off and on. This helps me to see what a filter's contributing to the overall effect. Notice how little the colour enhancer contributes to this example. Now compare that with the sunshine filter. This filter is adding a useful effect, but the effect is too strong overall. I can bring the filter into better balance with the other filters using the opacity slider. Equally, I know the colour enhancer is too weak, so I can increase the strength of the orange enhancement. I'll also use this to shift the blue away from purple and more towards cyan. And if I make the adjustment too strong, I can adjust the filter opacity. Now let's look at something else that's often overlooked. Just because I chose the On1 Effects plugin in Photoshop doesn't mean I can only use that one. In this image, for example, I see the mid-ground hills are a little too dark after adding the filters. This would be difficult to fix using only the filters and their layer masks. The easiest way to fix the problem is by switching to the Develop module and using the tone adjustments. Now I can lighten the shadow and midtones and increase the haze adjustment. Now let's look at another useful feature that's often missed. Watch what happens when I increase the structure slider. The effect is too strong and I decide I don't want to use it. The easy way to reset the slider to its default is to double click on either the slider or its title. The adjustments so far have improved the image, but I can see what suits the hills doesn't work well with the foreground. As I said earlier, just because we launched the effects plugin, it doesn't mean we can't use other On1 features. Let's go over to the local adjustments panel and use it to select the foreground. I'll just add a graduated filter and position that over the area I want to select. Notice the selected area becomes darker because the exposure is set to -1 by default. This makes selecting the area much easier. Now I can darken that area and use the controls to balance it with the upper part of the image. The other localized area I want to improve is the sky. I can make a second selection to adjust the sky by adding a new adjustment. Now I can select the sky. Before reducing the highlights. Another tip that's a great way to enhance a sky that's a little bit too light is using the haze slider. Dial in a haze reduction by moving the haze slider to the left. This works great providing you don't have any clipped highlights. What I can't do is recover areas that are blown out to white. Now let's go back to the effects section of On1 and look at adding one of my favourite filters, which is glow. Something else that's often overlooked is that we have a couple of ways to add more filters. Let's start by adding a glow filter using the Add Filter button on the right of the interface. This displays a list of available filters including glow. If I click to select it, a new glow filter appears, but the default settings don't have any effect. What we need to do is make our adjustments using the controls. An alternative approach is to select one of the glow presets as a starting point. If you decide to use a filter preset, don't make the mistake of thinking there are only three. There's a lot more in the drop-down list to the right. When I move my mouse over each of the presets in the list, I can see the effect on the image preview. The alternative to adding a filter in this way is to use the filter list on the left of the screen. Here you can see the different types of effect filters you can add. When I select the glow filter, I can see a series of small thumbnails representing the different presets. And if you click on one of these, the settings are applied to my filter. But here's another feature that's often overlooked. When I click this small grid icon in the title bar, it expands to show me a gallery previewing all the different presets. This makes comparing the different effects to pick the best one much easier. For this example, I'll select the radiance option. Whilst I like these settings, I think that they make the shadows a little bit too dark. What I'd like to do is restrict the effect to only the midtones in the image. There are a couple of ways I could do this, but I'm going to use another feature that's often overlooked. When I click the cog icon at the top right of the filter, it expands the filter. Now I can use the drop-down to select to apply the filter to only the midtones. Initially, this doesn't have any effect. What I also need to do is increase the range slider, which is set at 0 by default. This controls the range of midtones affected by the filter. Whilst I like the effect it's having on the foreground, I don't like the effect on the more distant hills. The fix for this is again something that's often overlooked, which is the filter mask. By this I don't mean that the masks are overlooked, but it's that you can combine masks with the range selection. By adding a gradient mask, I limit the adjustment to only the foreground. The final thing as I finish off the image relates to the filter panel on the left of the screen. Earlier when I clicked on one of the presets, it updated my glow filter with new settings. In fact, it did much more than that. It actually replaced the entire filter. If I clicked on, say, a dynamic contrast filter, that filter would have replaced my glow filter. To add a new filter rather than replace one is easy. I just need to hold down my Option key or Alt key on my keyboard. Then when I click on the diffuse glow filter in the list, I add a second glow filter. I'll then use the mask on that filter to restrict it to the sky. Now the image is finished, I can just tweak any of the opacity settings to fine-tune the result. In case you're wondering, here's the starting image again. I hope that today's video has highlighted at least a few new options for editing in On1 that perhaps you were ignoring. If you've enjoyed the video, please take a moment to share it. I'm Robin Worley, you've been watching LensCraft, I'll see you soon for another video.